the hopes they won't need to contact the CEO, who's sitting down to dinner, who may need to inform investors, who might ask for a sit-down with the CEO.
Live from Las Vegas, it's theCUBE, covering Knowledge 16, brought to you by ServiceNow. Here are your hosts, Dave Vellante and Jeff Frick.
Welcome back to Las Vegas, everybody. This is theCUBE. We're here live at the Mandalay Bay Hotel. This is ServiceNow Knowledge. It's actually, I think, the third day of the conference, the second day for theCUBE. And we've been going wall-to-wall coverage. A full day yesterday, capped off by Secretary Gates, the 22nd Secretary of Defense for the United States, appointed by George W. Bush and asked by President Obama to continue along. It was quite rare that an outgoing secretary is invited to participate in the following administration. It was really a pleasure to have him on. It's great, theCUBE sometimes, you get guests like that, it's a real privilege. We had Reggie Jackson on the East Coast at SAP Sapphire, and Reggie Jackson actually had been on before, but pretty fun interview, Jeff. And it's great, you get these opportunities, and these big names come in, billionaires, you know, like Michael Dell, and others, Scott McNeely, and then fun folks like Reggie, and then real serious dudes like Robert Gates.
He was very serious. I know you've read all of his books and you're a big fan, and I was struck by, you know, kind of just the simple kind of Midwestern values that were really, as you know, he laid down as really the key to leadership. Stuff that you need to have, and it can be reinforced, but it's not something that you're taught in school.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he was busy, and but gracious was the time, so many other areas I would have loved to go into, but so today was keynote, day two keynotes. Dan McGee, who's the COO of ServiceNow, will be coming on in just a moment, was up sort of hosting the day two keynotes. A lot of discussion about service management across the enterprise, embedding ITOM and ITSM, some demos on security. I think this is one of the least understood but greatest upsides of this company is the whole security play. Really trying to integrate all these bespoke security tools and to give you a single view of how to respond to security incidents. We're going to make that a theme of certainly day two and day three, talking to the practitioners about how they're solving that security problem. Also, a lot of talk about systems of engagement. Dan showed a capability called Connected, which is basically like a Slack-like capability, but it's integrated inside of ServiceNow. And any of you have used Slack or instant messaging, you got to go outside of your workflow and do it, and then go back. ServiceNow trying to make it easy to subscribe to channels and things like that. And so that was good. We're gonna unpack some of that today. Jeff, I've been talking to some of the investors coming out of the financial analyst meeting, just digesting things. They're really obviously very happy about the progress that ServiceNow has made. As you know, stock took a hit in January along with everything else. Actually took a hit last year too when they missed their quarter. Well, not missed, they just didn't beat by as much as people thought they were going to beat by. One of those deals.
Right,
remember
right.
We had Frank on.
Well, expectations, right? It's all about expectations.
And we were saying to Frank last year, like, look, if you got a $10 billion market cap, stuff like this is going to happen. And he said, I'm not worried about it. We talked to him yesterday about, you know, I used the term 90-day shot clock, which I stole from Michael Dell, and as a private company, Dell's not on that anymore, but as a public company that's doing really well, you know, Slootman and Scarpelli and company, I think they have their sights set on the broader vision. So while they obviously have to service Wall Street on a quarterly basis, you know, they don't get too excited when Wall Street gets excited, they don't get too depressed when Wall Street isn't. But some of the feedback I've heard from the investors is things like, you know, they're so micro-focused, which you understand, that's the Wall Street mentality, focused on like a deceleration in booking or in billings, right? I mean, still growing like crazy, but growing less robust than bookings, and so they're sort of micro-analyzing things like that. I think it's just sort of anomalies in the quarter when people come online. I'm not concerned about that at all. ServiceNow average contract values continue to go up because they're able to upsell. So that is sort of interesting, but I'm not so concerned about it. The other concern I heard, which is kind of funny, was talking to you off air, tongue in cheek, is the investor's concerned about how does ServiceNow do in an AWS-led world? And I don't get that concern. Right? Do you? Does it make any sense to you? I mean,
no, I don't get it. It's funny you bring up AWS because I think of Bezos and the way he treats the stock market as either jump on my train or not. I really don't care. I'm going to do what I'm going to do, and then look what has happened with AWS, right? And the money that and they finally kind of opened the kimono that they're making. So I don't know why they would do that. It certainly makes sense to partner with Microsoft. Satya is doing his thing. He was also at SAP Sapphire this week as well. So Microsoft and their cloud vision and Azure is really aggressive. So that part of it makes sense. I don't know if there's a security concern or something inside some of their enterprise clients that they prefer to be on a Azure cloud versus AWS cloud. Maybe that's part of the reason. Yeah, I mean, or just, you know, you don't want the vulnerability of a single vendor, you know, some of those kind of basic things. I think AWS is pretty solid.
My inference was they're worried that, you know, AWS is going to, you know, eat the world, which it is, but it's, you know, still a $3 trillion market. But you had mentioned, made a really good point. Last year, they were spinning up instances on AWS. What was your point on
that? Right. And Frank mentioned it on the interview. I think he said they spun up like 50 or 60,000, I'm probably getting the number, instances of ServiceNow here for the various training, certification, et cetera. And it was 100% AWS. This year, it's 50-50.
AWS and AWS,
and they just had Microsoft was just on the keynote this morning as well. So, I don't know, is it a hedge, is it another partner? I wouldn't read much into that.
Well, I mean, to me, it's just giving customer choice, right? So,
right.
AWS is infrastructure, and Amazon does a fantastic job of automating, you know, all the processes and procedures. You've heard my rap and my curves on bringing marginal costs down to zero for incremental volume for spinning up servers and compute and network resources and other ancillary infrastructure software. You know, clearly Amazon's moving up the stack into data with things like Kinesis. You're seeing with things like Aurora and Redshift, you know, getting into the database world, but that's still fundamental infrastructure. It's not, today anyway, in the application business. Microsoft, of course, is, and we'll talk about them in a second, but I just think if a customer wants to run ServiceNow and AWS, great, but ServiceNow is an application provider. An expert in workflow and understanding how to work and service requests and, you know, deep expertise in that area. That's not Amazon's wheelhouse.
Right.
And now Microsoft is interesting. I mean, Microsoft's into CRM, it's into ERP. So, you know, that could be. But I think, excuse me. Bless I think you. Again, in that instance, it's about infrastructure. And yeah, maybe Microsoft will try at some point to try to come up with ways to compete with ServiceNow, but ServiceNow to me has such a lead. If I were ServiceNow, I'd be, you know, from a competitive standpoint, I'd be more worried about, you know, BMC getting its act together and trying to, you know, improve Remedy, or maybe HP with a company with those resources, which I think, you know, BMC's probably closer to having, you know, a solution that is more competitive than it was 5 years ago. HP still, you know, playing big time catch up. But as they're catching up, ServiceNow moves on. So I don't think they're even that worried about that. I think they're very much focused on the customer. I don't know, it just feels like this company has, you know, great momentum and good vision and getting great feedback from the customers, and it's very customer-centric. So
right. The thing wins. I keep seeing is kind of the Kanban and kind of this new generation of programming. They don't approach it as programming here. It's really about the citizen programmer here. It's stitched together a workflow using these tools, but I keep seeing on the visualization boards, I go back to like Jira and some of that kind of the classic that came out of from the hardcore developer tools that are making it a little bit different. So I wonder if there's some bump there, you know, are they going to kind of run into that space as this defines kind of a new type of programming? What's going to happen with kind of classic programming? I don't know enough to know. With the shared services beyond ITSM, with HR, with marketing, with legal,
facilities,
there just seems to be so much opportunity to get more business inside their existing accounts as they do grow other accounts as well, that as long as the value exceeds the price and the cost to deliver it, seems like a lot of opportunity to kind of land and expand.
And I started telling you, I talked to in the gym this morning, I ran into somebody in the financial services world. Now, ServiceNow does a ton of business in financial services with ITSM and so forth, but what this individual was telling me is that his firm has basically automated the banking workflow So, you know, you got marketing, facilities, HR, banking workflow.
Right, right.
Which is a really interesting story. He told me he wants to come in the Cube next year and tell us about it. So, big day today. Dan McGee's coming on. We're going to talk to him. He's the COO of ServiceNow. We got CIOs coming on. We got practitioners. More innovation coming out of ServiceNow knowledge. So keep it right here. The Cube, SiliconANGLE's flagship production. We'll be right back after this short break.
Every once in a while,